Since the problem of demarcation was introduced in the philosophy of science, there's been many attempts and many different solutions offered to this problem of distinction. I want to tell you about one in particular that has been hugely influential, and one that is probably most popular with scientists. It was offered up by a Viennese philosopher by the name of Sir Karl Popper. Just a note on slide notation, when I have a microscope at the top, these are extra information that I'm sharing because I find it interesting and gives context to what we're talking about. I'll never test you on anything like this, but I do think it affords a little bit more interest to the actual problems we're discussing. Now, Karl Popper grew up in Vienna in the early parts of the 1900s, and this was a really interesting time in the world for different theories. Around this time was when Einstein was offering up his special and general theories of relativity, Alfred Adler and Sigmund Freud were talking about their theories of human behavior, and Karl Marx was talking about his theory of history. Now, all of these enterprises were generally regarded as scientific, but not for Popper. Popper only thought that Einstein's theories actually counted as real science. Now, Popper was impressed by Einstein in his openness to criticism, specifically his ability to create testable hypotheses that, if falsified, would actually undo the theory. Now, Popper's emphasis on the openness to criticism stems from what we can think of as probably the most straightforward criterion of demarcation, the way in which a theory or evidence is supported by empirical data. But pseudoscience is full of observation. Astrology, for instance, makes appeals to astrological and historical observations all the time. Alfred Adler and Sigmund Freud's theories of human behavior talk at great length about empirical observation. However, observation is cheap, and standards of support are weak and too flexible. Popper was unimpressed with all these other theories' ability to fit different data. However, Einstein's general theory of relativity made a very specific testable prediction that light would be bent by the gravitational force of the sun, a prediction that could actually be falsified. So, when in 1919, Arthur Eddington verified that light was indeed bent, it convinced a lot of people that Einstein's theory was right. But for Popper, this didn't matter. What mattered was that Einstein had made a testable prediction, something that, if Eddington had not observed the apparent shift in the star, would have falsified the theory of general relativity. It was this falsifiability that made the theory scientific in Karl Popper's view. And this led to what was known as the criterion of falsifiability, the perspective that for a hypothesis, theory, or enterprise to be regarded as scientific, it must be falsifiable, that is to say, refutable, on the basis of some physical observation. Now, we need to regard this as a necessary, but not sufficient criterion of scientific knowledge. What I mean by this is just because something is falsifiable doesn't make it science, but for something to be scientific, it must make statements that are falsifiable. So, for instance, I can make the falsifiable claim that Karl Popper will strike me down in 5 seconds for glossing over the nuances of the criterion. Okay, it didn't happen. That was falsifiable. But I didn't just do science right then. There are certainly other characteristics of science that are needed for something to be scientific. But note that this is a necessary criterion. For an enterprise to be regarded as scientific, it must be falsifiable. And this is a very important characteristic of science, and one that allows scientific ideas to be refined and to move forward. Now is a good time for us to actually move into a more specific discussion of what characteristics we consider science to have. And you'll notice one final notation, an exclamation point here, just means that these are very important information. I definitely want you to remember. Now, science has certain characteristics, and we've already seen two of them, that science is empirical. It rests on physical observation of the world, and it produces claims that are falsifiable. If there is an enterprise that produces a claim that cannot possibly be falsified, then this cannot possibly be scientific. Now, science has two other characteristics we need to concern ourselves with. The next is that science is objective. This cannot be overstated. To be scientific is to say that others who are not growing up in your same culture, are not seeing the world in the same way, will still make the same observations and come to the same conclusions as you. To be scientific is to say that anyone, anywhere, should observe the same phenomenon and come to the same conclusions. We don't think that science is a subjective enterprise. Some truth in the world cannot be true just for one person. Now, the final characteristic is that science is public. That is, when we come up with scientific ideas, we put them into the general pool of scientific discourse such that others can test and confirm our observations of the world. The purpose of being public is to make sure that observations we make are confirmed by other individuals. And this in some way relates to the objectivity of science. We want to make sure that there is a consensus among individuals participating in science on the ideas that we consider to be true in the world. Now, science being public is also meant to stop people from maliciously influencing the scientific discourse. For instance, very recently, psychology has been in a little bit of an uproar over the reproducibility of certain studies. Now, reproducibility has lots of different consequences and different issues, and we can talk a lot about all of those, but Diedrich Stoppel is a good example of a failed scientist. This scientist admitted to faking dozens of scientific studies, even faking data on some of his graduate students, the PhDs of which are in a little bit of contention right now. So he certainly has failed at being a scientist. And remember why we're doing all of this. The whole purpose of science is not to build up one's own career or to promote oneself. The whole purpose of science is to move our entire civilization towards truth. There is no failure greater for a scientist than the faking of scientific data and the promotion of those data as truth in the world. Diedrich Stoppel failed as a scientist.